Yesteryear in Nashville. A journey into the past with the people who made country music history. And now here's your host, Archie Campbell.
Back in 1959, the entire nation became familiar with a group from Arkansas made up of two sisters and a brother. Later, when his two sisters retired from show business, he achieved success as a solo artist. And we'll be right back to meet him after this message.
Green and Bonnie Brown were growing up in Sparkman, Arkansas. They listened to the Grand Ole Opry every Saturday night on a battery-operated radio. They even ordered the song books that were advertised so they could sing along with the opera stars. All that practice paid off when Jim Ed and Maxine made their first record in Shreveport, Louisiana in 1954. When they went to Nashville to appear on the Ernest Tubbs Show, they were heard by a Columbia Records executive who liked their songs and signed them to a recording contract. Their first record for Columbia was a song they had written themselves, Looking Back to Sea, which became a hit. In 1955, Sister Bonnie joined the group, and from then on, they were billed as the Browns. After joining the Ozark Jubilee that same year and signing a recording contract with RCA Victor the following year, they went on to record the smash hit million-selling The Three Bells in 1959. They joined the Grand Ole Opry, appeared on many national TV shows, and toured around the world. In the meantime, winning several awards. In 1965, Bonnie and Maxine persuaded Chet Atkins to record Jim Ed as a single. After he began touring as a solo artist, his sisters retired from the music business to stay home with their families. Jim Ed has continued to grow as a star with several top 10 hits and a number of awards to his credit. Here's the Browns singing the hit that made them famous, The Three Bells.
There's a village hidden deep in the valley, among the pine trees half forlorn. And there on a sunny morning, little Jimmy Brown was born. Bum, 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 all the cattle go. Little valley town, and the songs that they were singing was for baby Jimmy Brown. And the little congregation prayed for guidance from above. Lead us not into temptation, bless this hour of meditation, guide him with eternal love. There's the village hidden deep in the valley, beneath the mountains high above. And there, 20 years thereafter, Jimmy was to meet his love. Bum, 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 bum. All the chapel bells were ringing. 'Twas a great day in his life, 'cause the songs that they were singing was for Jimmy and his wife. And the little congregation prayed for guidance from above. Lead us not into temptation, bless the Lord this celebration, may their lives be filled with love. From the village, hidden deep in the valley, one rainy morning, dark and gray, a soul winged its way to heaven. Jimmy Brown had passed away. Bum, 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 bum. Just a lonely bell was ringing in the little valley town. 'Twas farewell that it was singing to our good old Jimmy Brown. And the little congregation prayed for guidance. Lead us not into temptation, may his soul find the salvation, of thy great eternal love.
That was one of the biggest hits of 1959, The Three Bells by the Browns. And with us today is Jim Ed Brown, who started his recording career first with his sister Maxine and then Bonnie.
Jim Ed and I, well, we, us and the Browns, had one thing that we both thought was a great record, and I still think it was a good record, called the 12th Rose.
The 12th Rose. I still get requests for that every once in a while.
Yeah, you know, it was to a select few people, it was a great thing, but it didn't sell any records.
Well, it was a great story.
Yes, indeed it was.
The 12th Rose, that, there's a, you know, a lot of people even today send 11 roses, and then say the 12th rose is you.
Is you, yeah.
And that's kindly what the song was written on. You know,
I wonder if that happened before he wrote it, or did the song inspire that little thing?
I think that was true before he wrote it.
Oh, it was?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it was a beautiful thing. Like, mm-hmm. I sent you, anyhow. You haven't heard it, have you?
Chances are they haven't, because I don't know about your copy, but ours, I think it sold 12. Mother and Daddy bought 10. I bought one, you know.
Well, you did have one, brother, the Three Bells. How many did it sell?
Archie, the Three Bells is...
still selling.
I don't know, but what, it's in excess of 3 million, somewhere in that vicinity. But the Three Bells was a great song. It was another one of those story songs.
And, so it's the 3 million?
Told the life of a man from birth through marriage. You know, very short, but such a... You know, it was put together so well.
Was a whole script, but the movie.
Right. The Three Bells was the first song that ever was number one on the country charts, the pop charts as we knew them then, and the rhythm and blues.
Uh-huh.
That's what the charts were called at that time.
Okay. And was that originally a French song?
Les Trois Cloches.
What?
Les Trois Cloches.
The Lit story. Cockroach.
No. No,
that's what he said.
It is
Lit Cockroach.
That's the French pronunciation for it. It was originally an old French folk song, and Edith Piaf first had the song, mm-hmm. and then she recorded it with a group called the Les Compagnons de la Chanson Singers, which is a French group that came over, and they did it on the Ed Sullivan Show in 49.
And do it in French?
No, they did it in English, mm. but the song originally was about 6.5 minutes long. But it was a song that I remembered from that time. And then, while I was still in school, I really liked the song. So in 51, I was in the Pine Bluff High School Choir, and our choir director's name was Mrs. Wright. I got her to get a hold of the sheet music on it. And she liked it so well that the entire choir at Pine Bluff High School performed The Three Bells.
And
I remembered it through the years, and it was, I always loved the song. And then finally, shall I tell you the rest? Maxine and Bonnie and I had been in the service for 2 years, from 56 to 58. And I got out of the service, and my father was in bad health. Maxine and Bonnie had both married. Both were having children. And I ran the sawmill for a year. No, we didn't. We did very little recording. We did no dates whatsoever, because I was having to work, because Daddy was, I told him, I said, you take off. You and Mama, y'all go fish, you hunt. Get away from here. I don't want to see you at the sawmill. Of course, I did. I needed him pretty bad a lot of times. But anyway, we came to Nashville. Chet called us and said, I think you need to come back in and record, you know, and we need another record on you. So on the way up here, we decided that this would be our last record session, because we were not doing anything. You know, we were not, our last hit was I Heard the Bluebird Sing, which was after I went into the service. And we were not working the road any. Maxine and Bonnie just couldn't do anything, and I figured all of my life that my job would be in the logging and lumbering business because of my father. So we decided that this was going to be our last recording session. And when we told Chet that, he said, well, is there any song that you have ever wanted to record that you didn't get a chance to? So we said, The Three Bells. We went into the studio and we started working on it, and he listened to it and he said, that's too long. We can't put that on record. You know, 6.5 minutes worth of song is just too much. They wouldn't play it back then. 2.5 to 3 minutes was a long record. In fact, they wanted them, you know, about 2 to 2:15. Mm. Well, The Three Bells, it ended up, it was about 3 minutes anyway, but we cut it out, and Anita Kerr and Chet and all of us sat down, and we changed the song, deleted some things, and it came out as it was. We left, went back to Arkansas, said, well, you know, no more. That's it. I got back on the log truck or lumber truck, and I was working in the woods and the mill, and, you know, just said, this is where I'm going to be the rest of my life. So one day, I pulled into, and I was dirty. I had been, it was dusty, it was hot. I was sweating, and the dust was, you know, I was coated. And I was thirsty, and I stopped at a little drive-in, and I had been there before, and they'd never had one of our records on. This was in Pine Bluff. Pine Bluff didn't support us either. Neither did the rest of the world, you know. But I heard this song playing, and I said, goodness, that sounds familiar. And I was too dirty to go inside and look at the jukebox. And I listened to it for a minute as I ordered the Coke, and I said, that's The Three Bells, which, you know, I didn't think anything more about. About 2 weeks later, fella from RCA in New York called, left a message for me to call him. I came in, mother told me about it. I said, you know, I don't know why he's calling, I don't have. So I didn't call him back. About a week later, he called me again. Mother said, that fella called again, said, you better call him. So the next day I came in from work about noon, and I stopped and called him. And he said, you know, you got a hit. And I said, no, I don't know, I got a hit, what do you mean? He said, well, The Three Bells is a hit. And I said, so? You know, what am I going to do? What am I supposed to do? He said, no, it's a hit. He said, it's selling 30, 40,000 a week. And goodness, we didn't sell that many records of, you know, total of the others. But The Three Bells was a great record. It was a beautiful song. And it came out, Archie, right in the middle of the rock era.
There's always been something I wanted to know about that song. It's about the fella called Little Jimmy Brown. Now, was that just a coincidence, or was that the name in the song?
That was the name in the song.
Oh, yeah.
That was just a coincidence.
We'll be right back with Jim Ed Brown after this. Both your sisters were singing with you, of course. And you started out singing with Maxine first, right. And then
Bonnie.
How did Bonnie come in? Is she younger or something?
Well, Maxine and I wrote a song called Looking Back to Sea, and finally we got Faber Robinson on the West Coast to record it.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, we recorded a song called Dragon Main Street, which didn't do too much. Looking Back to Sea was a hit. Then we recorded a song that
How
we wrote.
How was that? I was looking out to see.
I was looking back to see if you were looking back to see if I was looking back to see if you were looking back at me. It was a little play on words that our baby sister came in
Did
from school.
Did you write that?
Uh-huh.
Y'all wrote that thing?
Our baby sister came in from school one day, and she was telling, she was about 9 years old at the time, telling about how she had got this new boyfriend, you know. And she was walking down the street, and she got it all mixed up of how she was looking back to see if he was looking to see if she was looking at him, you know. And it just kind of stuck with us, and I was at work at in the woods, and I came in, and Maxine said, I think we ought to write this song. And she had already started writing on it.
Is it, did you, at one time, were you ever a forest ranger?
No.
But no, you I wanted started, to be, as I understand
well,
it.
Well, I started to school, and my major was, or started to college, excuse me, yeah. My major was forestry.
Oh.
Now, if I should have gone on for one more year, they wanted, they already had a place set up for me to go out on the West Coast. But they told me that what I would be doing would be sitting out in the middle of nowhere in a forest, and I would have this tower that I would go up and I would man it, you know, for like 16 hours a day, and somebody else would come on and, you know, give me relief every once in a while. And I said, I don't want to be in the middle of nowhere like that, doing nothing but sitting up there looking for smoke, you know. That's not what I wanted to do.
Jim, right now, let's take a look at you back in 1967 with your first top 10 record.
Right now, I think it's time to pop a top again. I've just got time for one more round. Set 'em up, my friend. Then I'll be gone and you can let some other fool sit down. I'd like for you to listen to a joke I heard today from a woman who said she was through and calmly walked away. I tried to smile and did a while, but it fell so out of place. Did you ever hear of a clown with teardrops streaming down his face? Pop a top again. I've just got time for one more round. Another one, my friend. Then I'll be gone and you can let some other fool sit down. Home to me is misery, and here I'm wasting time. 'Cause a row of fools on a row of stools is not what's on my mind. But then you see her leaving me is not what I prefer. So it's either here, a drinking beer, or home remembering her. Pop a top again. I've just got time for one more round. Another one, my friend. Then I'll be gone and you can let some other fool sit down.
That was Jim Ed Brown with Pop a Top. Yeah, you just did it. Do that one. Is that the sound you made?
No, we used the cam. Actually, we used the cam.
The real McCoy?
Well, we used the Dr. Pepper.
You're going to get the Browns back together again.
How did you know that?
I heard that, man.
Did you?
I certainly hope so. There's a sound there that I don't care how many trios you work up, it won't be the Browns.
You know Tom Perryman.
Oh, yes.
Tom Perryman has been a friend all the way from the very beginning. Well, Tom has kept encouraging us through the years. Bonnie really quit because, number one, she was married to a doctor. Mm-hmm. And she still is. She still is. And he was doing quite well. Once he got out of school and all, he started into business, and he was doing quite well. And it was the money that she made, most of it was going to taxes anyway. She was having her family. She had two young ladies, beautiful young ladies now. And she just got tired of the business. She didn't want any part of it. So she's the one that quit. And then Maxine had to have an operation, and she knew that she was going to be out of business for about 2 years. And that's the reason that everything just kind of broke up. Maxine had her family, and her husband was a professional man. He was a lawyer. And he didn't want her on the road. So it just got to the point where something had to be done, and I had to make a living. I had a little boy that needed some shoes, and I had to work.
Yeah,
And they couldn't work. Bonnie didn't want to, Maxine couldn't. So it just got to the point where something had to be done, and they decided that they were going to get out of the business.
We'll be right back with Jim Ed Brown after this. Hits. I heard the bluebirds sing.
I met a girl out in the hills who gave my lonely heart. And when I looked into her eyes, I thought of blue summer skies. And when I held her hand in mine, I heard the bluebirds sing.
They sang of wondering,
wondering if you love her.
Will she marry?
Marry if you'll ask her.
Will her heart be
true for him for
then and evermore? And when she's lonely,
lonely, is he near her?
When there's sadness,
sadness, will he cheer her?
Will they always,
always be together?
Until in death they part. And when at last spring touched the earth, we were married in the village church. Our wedding seemed just like a dream come true. So many years have come and gone, our love is still as true. Strong as one I found along the hill, and still the bluebirds sang. They sang of loving,
loving every hour.
That I married,
married to my flower.
Will be happy,
happy ever after.
As since the day we met, though we're older,
older, love is sweeter.
We grow fonder,
fonder of each other.
We'll be sweethearts,
sweethearts close together,
until the end of time.
You got any little old funny stories that have happened to you on the road? We try to get a funny story out of everybody, you know, that something that happened along to you.
There's been an awful lot of things that happened. Just first to my mind is, we were, this is, Maxine and Bonnie were still with me at the time, or we were together. We were in Oklahoma City playing a park, and they had a lion act on prior to us. And the lions, they performed well. We got on stage, we started singing, and we went through the almost the entire show, and we started singing the three bells. And I guess the harmony or the sound or something got to the lion's ears. They started roaring. And they roared, every one of them, and they roared so loud that we had to quit. You know, it was just louder than the PA system was. So we had to quit. Everybody had a little laugh, and we go back into it again. The lions quit roaring. They start again. Every time we did the three bells, the lions roared. Never figured that out, except it must have been something to their ears.
Some sound like sound that hits a dog's ear, you know, and that human beings don't hear it.
That's true.
Well, Jim, now you've come a long ways. You got a beautiful philosophy on life. What kind of goals do you have now?
Archie, I still think there's a lot of things left for me.
You got a brand new show you just put together, right?
Right. I have two young ladies that and a great band.
We've been talking with Jim Ed Brown, so join us again for Yesteryear in Nashville.
Material. I was working with a little dance band there, and she was writing songs, and when I come off the back from the job at night, she'd say, "Hey, look what I wrote today." And I'd listen to it, and